C# gave us record classes so we can define new types in a blink of an eye. Every type can be a one-liner if that is what you want. But how do we define behavior on records? Well, records are functional types. So in this video, I will show you how you can add or define functional behavior on a record using the latest C# syntax. I will only use vanilla C#, no external libraries, nothing, only the latest C# syntax. Some pieces of syntax you may have never seen. This single line of code is hiding some 50 to 100 lines of code behind, but I didn't have to write them. There's a lot of theory about records alone. I have another video, you can watch that to learn about the records. This is the beginning of the demo. I'm creating a couple of objects. I'm actually creating a book instance. But some factory functions might return null to indicate validation failure. So I'm checking whether any of the objects I attempted to create might be missing, and I quit early. My demo still does not incorporate optional objects, which are not part of C#, unfortunately. So I'm just doing it with nullable objects so far. So I want to add behavior to the book. For example, watch this. I want to prepare another name so that I can append it at the end of the list of authors of that book. That would be behavior, appending one author at the end of the list of authors. In functional modeling, objects are actually values. They are immutable. You cannot append anything at the end of whatever. Every mutation requires you to create a new instance with the modified content. In that light, C# defines with expressions. Watch this. I can create a new book with authors consisting of all the authors from the existing book and one object added at the back. Collection expressions are quite new in C#, and I would suggest you to learn how they work. But I see a problem here. What if this author I'm adding already exists in the list of authors of that book? So I might do it differently. I might ask whether the list of authors already contains the new object. If it does, then I just take the existing book without making any changes to it. What you see here is the pattern matching expression. We match objects against patterns and choose which expression to execute depending on which pattern we see. There's one more element you must be aware of here. How does this authors.contains work on my record object of the type name? That is where records come to the picture, because record classes implement value type semantic, and this object gamma would be compared by value, not by reference, to the existing name objects in the author's collection. So yes, this contains call will work as I expect. And it will work that way out of the box. I didn't have to write a single line of code to make it work. More. This could be the add any author lambda, which accepts a book and a name and returns a book. There are no classes here to define methods on them. That is the principal distinction between functional and object-oriented design. However, func delegates are cumbersome. Their arguments have no names. I don't know what this means. How can I give meaning to this func delegate? We do that by defining strongly typed delegates. Look at this. I will define a public delegate type. Call it addAuthor. It receives a book and a name and returns the book. That is the same thing as that func delegate I had, but this one is strongly typed. If I used the addAuthor strongly typed delegate consistently in all cases, you will see that lambdas are assignable to a strongly typed delegate. You can define behavior with a lambda without writing the entire class to contain it. It makes sense to define some defaults for a delegate type. Look, I will provide one implementation, I will provide another implementation. These are two variants of the delegate. I will use them in a moment and you will see. Before that, I want to twist your brain. I can turn the static method with the same signature as that delegate into a property getter returning that delegate and then return a lambda. I will just assign one of those properties to this strategy reference and use it. It is so easy. But there is one detail here. Why did I have to write the class name here? It just makes no sense. In functional design, classes are actually modules. When you don't want to see the class name because it doesn't serve that purpose of being a business module, then you can go up and use one of the novel pieces of C# syntax, static using directives. And that will give me access to all static members of this class here as if they were defined in this place. Look what I will get now. Add unique author is just a function that is accessible to me here directly. This was functional behavior 101. Let's raise the bar. Before I implement what I have in mind, let me remind you that you can download the entire source code and even more than what I am showing in the demo in the YouTube video from my Patreon page. It is not just about the source code and other goodies that you will find on my Patreon page. It is that every patron is helping hundreds of other programmers watch all the videos on my YouTube channel for free. So please join me on Patreon and help me maintain this channel free forever. You will find the links in the description. This kind of code is quite common. You will often see it. I'm creating a book and then adding one author after another until all authors have been exhausted and the resulting book is the ultimate result of the entire operation. But you will certainly know that this pattern is what link aggregate operator actually does. It starts from the seed, that is the book with a title and an empty list of authors, and then I need to append one author after another from this collection of authors. But all I need to supply is just a function which does that. When using delegates, you must use this invoke member wherever a func delegate is required, because the strongly typed delegates are not assignable to func delegates even when their signatures match. I hope to see the improvement in C# to allow assignments like this one. That would really be nice, but right now that doesn't work. All right. I have shown you how you use property getters that return delegates, but that doesn't convince anyone, I guess, that this is really needed. I could supply a static method over there and everything would work fine. Why did I return the delegate here? Well, understanding that will raise your knowledge to an entirely new level. When you return a delegate, you have returned an object. Have you heard that C# supports first-class functions? That means that functions have become proper objects the same way as any other object. That means, for one thing, that you can define an extension method on a func delegate. When there is a delegate that receives a couple of arguments, we can partially apply arguments to it. For example, by only accepting the first one, returning a smaller func delegate which expects the rest of the arguments. Let me show you the coding pattern, a typical use for this. What is the type of this delegate? It is a func delegate receiving a book and a name and returning a book. But then, if I start from the same delegate and call that apply, What will the type of this be? The apply method, static method, returns a new func delegate, and that is the func delegate which only receives the name and returns the book. So technically, I could append a name to I don't know what, and the result will be a book. Let me show you the coding pattern where that becomes important. You know already, I can condense that by using the select link operator. But the select link operator requires a function that receives the name and returns the book. And all I have got is the function that receives a book and the name and returns the book. Well, that does not fit here. All right, start from that delegate, but then apply the book partially to its argument list and obtain that func delegate which receives the name and returns the book just as the select operator requests. I will now step up and show you even a more complicated portion of code where we also need to define behavior, and we will define behavior in functional style. This is the definition of that name type which I was using through the entire demo so far. This is as close as C# has got to discriminated unions so far. I have an entire video dedicated to designing functional types, so if this portion of code is confusing you or anything you saw before is confusing you, please watch that video about functional types specifically. Since C# still does not support discriminated unions natively, we must find a less elegant solution than the one that exists in other languages that do support discriminated unions. And so here you can see that I am defining a general mapping from the name type to some unknown type R. To define that behavior, I need two func delegates. One would map the full name type and another would map the mononym type. Implementing this method relies on pattern matching. So there are two patterns here. I'm using the switch expression syntax, another functional addition to C#. Unfortunately, C# cannot check yet whether there are any other implement or subtypes of the name type, so we must include the catch-all branch in the switch expression and throw until discriminated unions come to C#. We must use creative workarounds like this map extension method here. But now let me show you how we use this kind of behavior when designing functional behavior in a domain model. For example, I might want to print those authors on the screen. Let me define a few default implementations, like formatting a full name. You have already got that process in your fingertips, I guess. How do we map an object of an abstract name type into anything? We do that by using the map extension method on that abstract type. And we just supply one variant and another variant. We cover all the angles and there will be a string on the output. I can define, I don't know, initials for matter or academic for matter. I can define whatever variants I like. In each case, I just need to supply two expressions, one for one variant, another for another variant, and let the map extension method do it all for me. All right, I'm inviting you to the most advanced section of this demo. Things will become hairy now. Besides formatting individual names, I'll also want to format entire name lists. A new delegate, which receives a delegate and the data. Here is a concrete implementation, one default implementation, comma separated names. So this large delegate is using the small delegate to complete a part of its work. However, why should I care as a caller Which strategy should be used to format individual names? That just doesn't fit my head. Let me fix that. I will call this an extended delegate, a large one. And let me define the small one. Format names list. The same problem, solving the same problem, but without knowing how each individual name has been converted to a string, that becomes somebody else's problem. A problem partial function application should solve for me. So let's define a partial application for the extended format names list and apply a name formatter, but leaving the list of names unbound. Now, this is a proper partial application for delegates when you take a large delegate and turn it into a small one. I will need the same for the entire books because I want to print the entire books on the screen. So there will be a large delegate and a small one. The large one expects the list formatter for all the authors. But the small one doesn't care to know that. It just takes the book and gives you the string. So I have it all. I want to start the new demo, and with this we will complete the entire demonstration, but this new demo will bind all these techniques you have learned so far together in a single expression. Start from the authors, but then I want to add each author at the back of the book. I do that by using the add any author strategy, apply the book partially, and that will give me a func delegate which applies an author and returns a book exactly as the select operator expects. Then I wish to change the title of each book I got. I will use a with expression. I just want a lambda and I want to have a book with a different title. Now I have the sequence of books and I want to format each of these books into a string. I will need a formatter for names. Also, I need the book formatter. I want to list names followed by the title. And then I want to apply that formatter for the list of authors. This delegate doesn't know how it will format the list of authors, and the list of authors formatter doesn't know how it will format each individual name. All these objects are part of the delegate's closures, and the signature doesn't show any of those. I will just apply the book formatter as it is, and I'm sure it will do the right job. This gives me the sequence of strings, so I can prepend an ordinal number to each of those and apply the right line strategy, so I will effectively print one book per line, formatted using these strategies I have listed above. You can see six books, each coming with the uppercase title, just as I wanted, and each having one author added at the back. If you also see the ordinal numbers, you will see that each of the lambdas I made in this demonstration has been executed. But look at the expression. Do you see any of those here? No, I just gave names to lambdas, and I only passed delegates around. That is how we define functional behavior. This code is very short, very efficient, very effective, and when you read the code, you will surely know what it does. Now, if you still don't know how to define effective functional types in your domain model, make sure to learn that as well.